In this class, you'll be expected to interpret molecular orbitals based on the linear combination of atomic orbital theory, or LCAO. We won't expect you to know how to manipulate that theory, but a little bit of background will be helpful. Let's start with something familiar. Here's the picture of the hydrogen atom, the energy diagram. The hydrogen atom in LCAO theory is derived by combining the two 1s atomic orbitals, one from each of the hydrogen atoms. And as a consequence of this combination, there are two new molecular orbitals that are created. One, known as sigma, which is energy lowering relative to the atomic orbital levels, and the other, sigma star, which is energy raised relative to those atomic orbital energy levels. Sigma looks like this, and most importantly, it's an overlap of the two 1s wave functions to generate a bonding interaction. There are no nodes because the signs of those atomic orbitals are the same, and so there's constructive interference between them. In contrast, sigma star looks like this. The signs of those two 1s wave functions are opposite. As a consequence, there is one node in between. The most important thing to take away from this diagram, which we're going to see time and time again in the coming lessons, is that the fewer number of nodes, the lower the energy. So the sigma orbital has zero nodes, while the sigma star orbital has one node. Here's what LCAO looks like mathematically. The molecular orbital sigma is derived by adding together contributions of the 1s orbital on atom 1 with the 1s orbital on atom 2. These numbers C1 and C2 are coefficients that tell us how much each of these atomic orbitals contribute to the molecular orbital. If this molecular orbital happens to be occupied with electrons, then the square of these numbers tell us how much electron density resides on this atom for this molecular orbital. Let's take a look at the LCAO results for the hydrogen molecule. They're conveniently represented in this square matrix form, where each row represents a molecular orbital. At the bottom, that's the bonding sigma orbital. At the top, that's the sigma star orbital. Each column represents an atomic orbital. First, that atomic orbital centered on atom 1, and second column is that atomic orbital centered on atom 2. You can see then the coefficients that contribute from an atomic orbital to a molecular orbital by reading any of these positions in this matrix. Notice that there's a sign inversion, 0.707 positive, 0.707 negative, for this sigma star. A very important feature of these coefficients is that the sum of the squares for any molecular orbital must be equal to 1. And so we can see that if we square each of these numbers and add them together, we get a value of 1. And the physical interpretation of that means that we have made a whole, a complete molecular orbital sigma star. The same rule applies vertically for any atomic orbital, say the one that's centered on atom 1. If we square those coefficients and add them together, we see that the value is equal to 1. Similarly for atom 2, if we square those coefficients and add them together, we also get a value of 1. The interpretation of this, in a physical sense, is that we have fully utilized the atomic orbital 1 in generating these two new molecular orbitals, and similarly atomic orbital 2 has fully been utilized in generating these molecular orbitals. Because the hydrogen atom is symmetric, each of the coefficients are identical, but later on we'll see many examples where the coefficients vary from one atom to another for the different molecular orbitals. That's the basis of the LCAO theory and the idea of coefficients. We're going to see that these coefficients can be found in WebMO calculations, and so immediately we can use them in order to interpret where the electron density is in any particular molecular orbital.